Hello and welcome back to another Thursday, another episode of the Sports Advantage. I am joined by UATV Sports Director here, Cameron Johnson. Cameron, how are you feeling?
I'm doing great, Ben. Good to be back.
That is always great to hear. And now, Cameron, we've got a lot to talk about with college football. We are just coming off an Arkansas win. So how are you feeling about the Razorbacks right now?
I think that they are finding their stride. Sure, the game against LSU was not the prettiest, but they got the job done. I think a few years ago, they probably might have caved under that pressure. So to see them, you know, hang in there and get that win in the boot, I think Arkansas is looking pretty good.
I mean, I think we all were watching that LSU game. The battle for the boot, as you said, Cam Little winning it by drilling a pretty much a normal kick. But also, I mean, it's still fun. Like, it was overtime, so it's like a big deal. Big deal. Arkansas, of course, coming out with a win. How are you feeling, though, looking forward to Alabama? Now, LSU is one thing. Their head coach is going out. And I don't think they're a good team this season. I just don't. But Bama has had some wavering the tide has wavered a bit, let's put it that way, in terms of they're not as strong as they used to be. They're not really crashing into teams and just, like, running through them like they used to. Tennessee held on for that first half against them. Texas A&M beat them, and we beat Texas A&M. Transitive property there. People are like, we're going to win. We don't know. But how do you feel going into this game against Bama, knowing Bama isn't necessarily the powerhouse it once was in years past?
I will agree with you. Alabama is nowhere near the team that we have seen in, honestly, the past 10 years or so. You know, they just about lost to LSU. I don't even think they won by a full touchdown. And I think that Arkansas, I've always said that Arkansas kind of plays to the level of the team they're playing, meaning, you know, sometimes they'll play, if we're playing a smaller team that should be a win, sometimes they'll make it a little more difficult than they need to. But at the same time, I think that Arkansas is able to compete. You know, they got a whole year with solely SEC play last year. I think that if ever there was a year for Arkansas to pull off the upset, it would be this year.
I completely agree. Alabama is the weakest they have ever looked in my eyes. And quite frankly, Arkansas has looked among the most competitive they have in the past 5 years this year. So I'm very much looking forward to this game against Bama. For all those on campus saying we want Bama, this is our time to shine here in Arkansas. This is the Razorbacks' time to come home with a win against one of the premier franchises in all of college football. So, I mean, let's look forward to that game. Let's see what happens. But I think I would say Arkansas is probably going to win this one. That's my take this week, is that Arkansas stands a great chance against Bama. We've got some great players. But, you know, defense, we're lacking Jalen Catalon. This has been an ongoing thing. Just because of his foot injury. Mm-hmm. But nonetheless, I am very much looking forward to this game. Shoulder injury for Jalen Catalon, not foot. I just knew, like, surgery happened there. Either way, we know that Arkansas looks good going to this Bama game, and Bama doesn't look as good, so let's look forward to that game and hopefully come out with a win.
I'll also throw in there, Alabama, I think, did I see that they put up only 6 yards against LSU? Whereas, you know, Arkansas has got that, they've got, the ground game is their game. So to see Alabama, of all people, barely put up any sort of ground offense kind of makes you wonder.
Absolutely. I mean, Bama is a team that, one, known for their running game initially anyway. Like, every year I feel like they've got the most amazing running backs in all of college football. But that defense has weakened. They're also known for their premier defense in the SEC, and that hasn't necessarily been here as much this season. So there's another weak spot. Great eye, Cameron, for that. But another game that happened this weekend, another one that went into overtime that I kind of snuck in the end, was Kansas versus Texas. Now, this has major repercussions for us in the SEC because Texas is a team that's supposed to be joining this conference in upcoming years. We really don't know how long it's going to be. They say what? They plan for like 2025, right?
Maybe.
But that could be sooner than later, just depending on how things work out. But nonetheless, how do you feel, Cameron, about this Kansas team, one? And how do you feel about this Texas team? This Texas team was one that was supposed to be like this big dog, like an AP-ranked team. And now they're losing to just like non-ranked teams. Like, how do you feel about Texas?
I will say, I grew up an Oklahoma fan, so I was raised to hate Texas. For years, I have seen Texas start off strong, the whole Texas is back thing, and then they end up falling off kind of midway through, and then they have a little bit of success in the bowls. I haven't agreed with Texas coming to the SEC. I think out of the Big 12, arguably you could say Oklahoma State might be a better team there, but still, kind of a toss-up. But I do want to credit Kansas, because Kansas not only beat Texas, they also just about knocked off Oklahoma earlier in the season. And there was a point in time where, like, Kansas even keeping it within single digits was a hard thought to process. So all credit to Kansas.
Yeah, I mean, Kansas looked phenomenal in that game. Of course, it came down to overtime, so... But, I mean, nonetheless, Kansas is not a football school. Like, I have never viewed Kansas as a football school. I know personally, it's like, Kansas, like, Rock Chalk Jayhawk, that's, like, all basketball. Like, mm-hmm. former greats played at Kansas. Like, Joel Embiid was a former Kansas. It's like, they are phenomenal at basketball. But nonetheless, I've never thought of them as a football school. Like, they just never crossed my mind there. They've been bad for many years. So good to see that program coming back to some relevance against UT here. I mean, like Texas, of course, they're like one of the most renowned college football teams. Whether that's justified or not, they are. So Kansas, big win in overtime. Way to get it done there. But let's move into some postseason predictions here, Cameron. Now, bowl games. Where do you think Arkansas is going to go? Like, we earned our seed as a bowl contender this year. Where do you think we're going to go?
I'm not sure what bowl specifically they'll end up at. I think I've seen floating around with a 9-3 record, the Outback Bowl might be a destination. As for who they play, I personally, you know, seeing how Oklahoma's played, I'm going to bring it back to them. I would like to see Arkansas and Oklahoma play. I think Arkansas has always been given the short end of the stick. Everyone doubts them. But then, you know, OU's going, thinking they're these big dogs, and even OU's not the team they used to be. And they've been playing arguably a way weaker schedule. So I would love to see those two play each other. I think I also saw Iowa is a potential option. I think that could be fun to watch a Big Ten SEC matchup. I think Arkansas is going to have a good postseason, I'll say.
I think it'll be a fun bowl season no matter what. We got a lot of good teams going into this. I am seeing like predictions of OU playing Ole Miss in like the mm-hmm. Sugar Bowl. How would you feel about that? I mean, it's another SEC team. Of course, it's not us, so we don't want that. We want the Razorbacks to play the next generation. I would love to see. I mean, I agree with you. A Arkansas-OU bowl game would be really fun, because if we could get a win there, then absolutely it would be Arkansas dominating two of the teams that are to join the SEC in future years. So that would be a fun one. But a lot of good teams in this bowl. I mean, like, I'm seeing Michigan State, mm-hmm. Oklahoma State playing in the Fiesta Bowl. A lot of these, like, New Year's Day bowl games are looking great. And it's going to be a fun postseason, not only for Arkansas, but all college football fans out there. I see Rose Bowl, Michigan, and Oregon. That'd be an interesting one.
Yeah.
But nonetheless, I mean, fun postseason. I'd love to see even, like, us play against, like, Wisconsin or something. One of those teams that, like, you just never see us go up against them.
Right.
And that's the thing is, like, if we do go up against OU, that's going to be a rivalry that is just to come in future years.
Mm-hmm.
But sometimes it's fun to just see someone you'll, like, never play again until the year, like, 2050, you know? So, interesting times in college football. Cameron, you got anything else to add about bowl games?
I don't think so. I mean, lots to come. It's going to be an exciting end to the season.
Absolutely. And we've also got that SEC championship to look forward to. I'm guessing it's probably going to be Bama and Georgia.
Probably.
Never know. I'll give credit to Heath Anderson, KXUA station manager. He was talking about, he also has a show on Wednesdays, on a radio talk show called Razorback on Air. Not a shameless plug there. good shout out to a good group of guys on that podcast. But nonetheless, he said there is a scenario in which Arkansas can still make the playoffs, the college football playoffs, and it'd be Auburn would have to beat Bama, but lose to, I believe, South Carolina.
Yes.
And Bama would have to lose both of their games. Mississippi State would have to beat Bama there. I view that as impossible. I don't think South Carolina's beaten anyone.
Yeah.
So, but
I'd like to see it, though.
I'm glad to see Heath coming up with these imaginative dreams of what Arkansas could be. But to be quite honest, this is not an Arkansas team that's ready for the college football playoffs. It would be a first round out pretty easily, I think, especially if we were against like the powerhouse that is Georgia. Georgia is, like, to me, a lock this year. I don't see any competition there. How do you feel about that, Cameron?
That's what they want you to think. No, I'm kidding. I think that Georgia is the team to beat. I don't see them losing a regular season game. I think the worst they do is lose the national championship at most. I think, you know, like you mentioned, Alabama's most likely going to be who they play in the SEC championship, and I think that will be maybe not a blowout, but I think Georgia should be heavily favored in that, and I think they're the team to beat. I don't think Alabama should deserve a spot in the playoff at all, especially after, you know, maybe Arkansas beats them.
I really do agree with you there. Well, Cameron, thank you so much for joining me on this first segment of TSA talking about college football. Thank you so much for joining me as always. But after that, we're just going to cut to a quick break and then we'll be right back with the NFL. Welcome back to the Sports Advantage. I'm joined by Ella Marshall, our resident NFL expert. Ella, how are you doing today?
I'm so good. How are you?
I'm doing fantastically, especially when we get to talk some NFL football. So professional football, Ella. Okay.
I'm so excited.
Yeah, so excited. So, first bit of news to get into, Cam Newton is back. He's with the Carolina Panthers, and he got two touchdowns. I mean, has the Messiah returned to Charlotte, North Carolina?
Well, hold up. His first play was a touchdown. They, like, planned that.
So, they,
like,
really did.
We can't say, like, he's back. That's by his word.
Well, he said it himself.
He did say it.
He said, I'm back. And I think that means he's back.
You know what? You're right. Never mind.
Okay. I mean, but nonetheless, Cam Newton, somebody who was, like, traded from Carolina just a season ago.
Yep.
And then played, like, nothing
with the Patriots.
He was really bad with the Patriots. And now he's back, and he was on the waivers, and everyone was like, who's gonna sign him? Like, Seattle, they're missing, like, gonna fill in? Whoever, like, bouncing around the NFL, like, rumor mill. But then we get back to Carolina where it all started.
Yeah,
so it's a big game though. Like, the game was big, they handed the Cardinals only their second loss of the season.
Yeah,
and Ella, I know you have a contingency. What's your contingency that you're adding?
Well, what do you mean? Are we talking fantasy right now?
Because I'm talking about, like, I said, oh, the Panthers beat the Cardinals. That's great. And you immediately were just like, well, Kyler Murray was out.
Yeah. Okay. Kyler Murray is suffering an ankle sprain right now. And so I fully believe if he was in, we would have had a better,
as if you're a Cardinals fan. Yeah.
Suddenly a fan of them.
Jumping on the bandwagon.
I think there would have been a better shot. I think part of it was the excitement. It was a home game for the Panthers. It was crazy. I mean, Cam Newton was on the sideline directing plays for a bit of it and, like, having hype-up talks, whatever you want to call that. So there was some energy behind it, I think, that has to contribute to it. But I think if Kyler Murray was in, there might have been a different story.
I mean, I have to agree, mostly because you know more about the NFL than me. But secondly, because I do think it was, like, Carolina. This is the return of their Messiah. Like, Cam Newton is, like, one of the most famous Carolina Panthers of all time. Like, he is cemented to them.
They will let you know that he was amazing at Auburn. Like, if you talk to a Carolina fan, they will relate back to how he was from Auburn.
No, absolutely. I have a few Auburn fans in my life that absolutely loved Cam Newton. So much so that they put it as his Xbox gamer tag. It was Auburn Cam growing up. So little tidbit about my life there and my friends. So people love Cam Newton, and I got nothing bad to say about him. I think he brings a good energy, and clearly it paid off.
I don't think he was who he was when he first was in the NFL. I don't think he's going to be what the Panthers expect him to fully be. I think he's going to be good. I just don't think he's going to be as great as he once was.
I completely agree. But moving on to another team that's taken losses from the Cardinals, who are at the top, to the Rams. So the Rams, Ella, we thought, like, oh, my God, this is the biggest super team in all of NFL history. They just got Odell Beckham Jr. They just got Von Miller. They just have, like, an arsenal of receivers. They've got the best defense in the NFL. And then they take two losses to two questionable teams.
I will die on this hill with what I'm about to say. I felt very hopeful for the Rams. The moment Odell was on the team, on the roster, I knew it was going downhill. Wow. Odell has a tendency to bring the problems with him. I don't think Odell is once who he was. He's not somebody who makes the iconic one-hand catches anymore. That's just not him. Mm-hmm. And I think that because he's not who he once was, he is, full of himself and doesn't like it that he's not at the caliber he once was.
Yeah, I do think it is telling when, like, the most recent big news I heard about Odell before the trade was, like, when he went and was with Joe Burrow and hanging out, handing people, like, $100 bills on the LSU sideline.
Which got fined anyways. Like, that wasn't even good.
Yeah, that was it was a really bad thing that he did. But either way, I mean, like, yeah, they added Odell. But first, I mean, even before that, they added Von Miller, lost to the Titans without Derrick Henry with, like, a 40-year-old Adrian Peterson.
Yeah.
Who scored a touchdown. Another old guy who's scoring touchdowns. Like, hey, they're making it in the NFL still. And then they added Odell, and they lost 30-10. Like, I just don't understand it. I really don't. Like, do you get it? Like,
no, I wish I could be like, well, this is the reason. But I don't know. The only thing, I did see an ironic thing where they were like, once they signed Von Miller, they were like, they released a tweet about, like, how great they're going to be, and they've gone no wins since, which is just ironic. But I think it's partially because the team kind of got ahead of themselves. Mm. This is the part where you start looking at playoffs, you start looking at really who is realistic in making it, and I think that they do have a very good shot at making it. But when you get too confident and you're underestimating your opponents are going to overplay you. And yeah. I think that's what's starting to happen with them.
And, I mean, the 49ers, if I may be frank, are one of the worst teams.
They're awful.
In the NFL right now.
So bad.
So this is an embarrassing loss. Like, even if it's at the 49ers' home field, like, absolutely embarrassing. They should be ashamed, frankly.
I want them to win this next game to prove that that was a fluke. But at the same time, I feel like maybe they don't. Like, there's a good chance they don't.
You know, maybe Von Miller just brought a bit of the Broncos with him to L.A., and maybe Odell brought a bit of the Browns with him to L.A. too. And
I'm not going to throw Von Miller in a bus. I have a special place. I'm a KC fan, and I have a special place in my heart for Von Miller.
Von Miller's a great player, but I don't think Denver did him any favors. I'll say that. But nonetheless, Ella, something you're passionate about.
Yep.
Your Chiefs are on a win streak after, like,
baby,
one of the most iconic slumps in NFL this season. So how are you feeling after this?
I wrote some notes on the prompter. I'm going to read it exactly. I misspelled Chiefs. I'm going to read it exactly the way.
Chiefs.
Chiefs, as I put it. The Chiefs still aren't great. They're not where they were when they were at Super Bowl level. Everyone else is just bad. I thought the Raiders were going to blow the AFC West out of the water. And then Henry Ruggs happened, and then they had the other player that I can't remember the name of who posted the TikTok of him holding a gun and being threatening, and then their franchise within itself, the team within the locker room, is collapsing right now, and it's starting to reflect on the field. The Chargers, I have really nothing to say about the Chargers. Broncos are just, the Peyton Manning left, they just kind of fell. Like, they're not great. They're average at best. Chiefs aren't good. They're not great. They're just playing at a level that is better than falling apart. And that's what I have to say.
I mean, I have to agree with you again, because you know far more about the Chiefs than me. But I do know, like, the Raiders have looked like they've just fallen apart. They've crumbled. Yeah. They started off the season really strong, but just have fallen off in recent years. And, of course, the Chargers, my Super Bowl favorite.
You did say that. I looked at you. I was like,
Los Angeles
insane.
Chargers. Yeah, I mean, so I think the Chiefs can at least salvage the season a bit with some wins along the way in the eyes of the casual fan. Maybe Mahomes won't look as good as he did that year with the Super Bowl. Maybe he'll get it back next season. But at least they can look like they are playoff eligible.
I still say they're not Super Bowl contenders. I don't think they're going to make it. I think I have somebody in my family who believes that Patrick Mahomes has kind of gotten soft since his daughter was born. I kind of believe that. I mean, I'm sorry. I kind of buy it because that's adding a child into your family is like kind of a lot. So I think that it's just kind of something where something really has to change within the Chiefs to make us realize that, like, you can't just have Patrick Mahomes carry you. Your defense has to become better. Chiefs defense is second last in sacks. Our pass rush is getting better, not good still. And we're playing the Cowboys next on Sunday. They're notoriously good.
That's true. I mean, I do feel like Ella, though, I don't feel like you can put that on him having a daughter. I've seen so many players have daughters and then just, like, ball out. Ja Morant has a daughter. Ja Morant is the fifth leading scorer in the NBA. This is the NBA, I know.
Okay, well.
So there's that. But nonetheless, I don't think that's true. I think it is a weird thing. We're going into this bizarro world in the NFL where, like, teams just have, like, off nights.
Yeah.
And I've got a stat here. Just most fun stat. 58% of underdogs this season have covered when going up in bets. Like, 50% of underdog bets have covered in the NFL this season.
Yeah.
So, I mean, that's definitely telling. When over 50% of the underdogs are, like, absolute, like, you might as well, this is not a show for betting advice. Do not bet. Do not gamble. If you have a gambling problem, contact the local state authority, whatever. That's my disclaimer.
Thank you.
But if you're going to bet, like, underdogs are looking really good this season. So, I'm not a betting man. And I implore our viewers to not be betting people either. But if you're going to, the underdog is more enticing than it ever has been this season, just because so many weird wins have gone. Just big teams have been knocked off by, like, the worst teams. It's like there's no competition between, like, the best teams, but then you've got, like, the Giants are going to beat the Cowboys or something, like, with this streak, the way it's going.
Well,
so
okay. I think we need to consider the fact that this is the first year post COVID. So you're having full stadiums. That's an adjustment when you go from limited capacities in stadiums. That's a new audience to cover. On top of that, NFL is considered very much America's sport right now. It's having high ratings across the board compared to other sports. And I think because of that, there is a new pressure for some of the new guys. Veterans, I'm not that worried about. I think some of the new guys who were recently drafted are playing on a bigger stage with just a lot of outside circumstances. And I think that's kind of playing into it. And there's also, there's new people who are into gambling. I mean, it's slowly becoming more of a like non-taboo thing.
Yeah, I mean, it's becoming legal in more states. Of course, Tennessee, it was legalized recently. So whatever, to each his own. But Ella, always appreciate your insight. Thank you so much for coming on to educate me on the NFL and our viewers, of course. So we're just going to take a quick break and be back with some NFL and college basketball news. Welcome back to the Sports Advantage. I'm joined by Carson Cann. We're going to talk some college basketball, and we got to get through it really fast. Okay, so first off, AP polls. Number one, we've got Gonzaga. Gonzaga is doing really well. They've got the number one recruit in America, Chet Holmgren, who is a 7-footer. He's averaging 9 points and 8 rebounds per game, and he's shooting phenomenally. How do you feel about – and we've also got Drew Timmy. Drew Timmy is, like, a phenomenal athlete right now. He's probably not going to translate to the NBA. That's why he didn't apply for the draft last season. But nonetheless, Carson, how are you feeling about the number one Gonzaga team?
You know, they came into the season ranked number one. I think they still got the number one spot as far as I'm concerned. I mean, it's so early in the season, but the way that team has played, I feel like they definitely, right now at least, deserve that number one spot. I don't think anyone's better than them right now.
I completely agree. I mean, their loss to Baylor last season was one that broke their hearts. But, of course, they got some returning players like Drew Timmy, I mentioned, who is just playing out of his mind this season. But, nonetheless, he's got 19.3 points per game and 5.3 rebounds per game. And so Gonzaga looks great. But number two, we've got UCLA. This is one I'm iffy on. To me, it's like they're just a whole team of just guards who can score. And their leading scorer is Johnny Juzang, who is leading the team with 21.5 points per game. Carson, how do you feel about UCLA being at that number two spot?
You know, UCLA, I feel like after the season they had last year, I feel like the number two spot's good for them right now. I feel like some people are kind of, they might think UCLA is number one right now. I feel like there's a little bit of debate over that, but I like the one and the two. I think UCLA, like you said, they're maybe not as diversified as Gonzaga with this team. I mean, like you said, they can score. But we're still at this point. I still think Gonzaga's number one. I think they got it right this week.
Yeah, I mean, and then we've got number three, Kansas. Kansas is looking great. Ochai Agbaji is looking phenomenal. He's a 6'5 guard who's averaging 17 points per game on 60.6% shooting. So Kansas, I think they deserve to be there. But nonetheless, we've got Arkansas sitting at 16. Carson, real quick, how do you feel about Arkansas sitting down there at 16?
You know, I like it. I love being the underdog. I mean, I think Arkansas, once they get their team rolling and stuff, last year we didn't start the season so hot with the SEC. I know we're not in SEC play yet, but we haven't started the season off so hot. So I think this year might have had a little rough start with preseason games, and that kind of made people a little bit iffy. But I feel good. We're 3-0. And I like us going into this little road stint that we're about to have. And I think that 16 is good. I'm good with 16. I still think we got a lot of room to improve. So
I'm good with 16, too. I think as a team, Bo and I highlighted last week the numbers. And they did not reflect team basketball. They reflected JD Notae going out there and just scoring. So nonetheless, I mean, Arkansas deserves to be at 16 until they can show that they need to be a bit higher. I know I've got two players to watch real quick, just before we end. Two players to watch, both from the University of Memphis. Jalen Duren, happy birthday, Jalen Duren. He just turned 18 years old. Woo! He is a 6'11 center with 12.7 points per game. He's averaging 5.7 blocks per game.
That's wild.
Insane numbers from him. 18 years old, just turned. He was 17 when he recorded those stats. 8 rebounds. 81% shooting. Now, his only weakness, he's shooting like 66% from the free throw line. But nonetheless, very impressive stats from a young player. And then the other one is Imani Bates. And Imani Bates is a 6'9 forward at the University of Memphis, averaging 16 points per game, 50% from three, and he's only 17 years old. This University of Memphis team is young, but they have a lot to prove. They've got some returning seniors. They got a dude on their team who's like 25 years old, who's crazy, DeAndre Williams. Look it up. The University of Memphis, mark my words, they are a championship caliber team.
They got a run in them. I think they're definitely Elite Eight headed. I think they should be. We talked about this a little bit before, but definitely should be higher than 12th. I mean, they got a great team under them. They are under a great coach, and I think this team really has a lot of potential.
Imani Bates is the best player at the University of Memphis since Derrick Rose. So, nonetheless.
You heard it here.
But nonetheless, they're both potential top five NBA picks for the future. So keep your eye on those two. They are going to be NBA talents. That is unquestionable to me. Just based off of what I've seen early in the season, this University of Memphis team has a really tough schedule ahead of time. They're at number 11. They're going to be in that top five by the end of this year. So, Carson, anything else you got to say about college hoops or the AP polls?
I don't think so. I'm very excited to see where this season goes. I think it's going to be we got a lot of good basketball ahead of us, so.
I completely agree. And we're all praying for March. March is going to be a fun time. It's always a fun time of the year in college basketball here on a college campus where we're expecting the Razorbacks to get into the tournament. If they don't, I think we'll all be crestfallen. Crestfallen, that's my $5 word for the day. But nonetheless, thank you for joining us for another TSA. Carson, thank you for coming on, of course, to talk some college hoops with me. Join us next week as we, well, actually, no, not next week.
Happy Thanksgiving, everyone.
Yeah. Okay. We'll tune into the TSA 2 weeks from now. Until then, enjoy Thanksgiving, and we are just going to be thankful for UATV and TSA as a whole. Have a good night.
Bye.